People are sitting down. Hi, I'm Yash. This is not the title of my talk. I thought it was funny to put on. I'm doing a talk about frameworks today, browser frameworks. thank you. Great. Hi, I'm Yash. Hi, Yash. Thank you. Okay, great. Hi, everyone. I am doing a talk on frameworks. I'm Yash. I work for a nonprofit called the DAP Project. We build peer-to-peer stuff. I build interfaces for this peer-to-peer stuff. We miss deadlines all the time, but we do build like really cool tech, which is what I'm sort of showing off today. The goal today is to show you how to build a modern framework. We just like saw a talk about Fiber. There's a lot of similar stuff in here, I think. Like, lots of the APIs are, like, being discussed. I was taking the seminar joke a bit further. That's why this slide is weird. building a Franken framework is very accurate, though. We'll be composing a few modules together and, like, creating our own framework. I just built it. So, worst-case scenario, live coding will fail, and I will, like, show you the thing I just built. So what's a framework? I've got a few frameworks. Probably my biggest framework right now is like Chew. Actually, I really dislike frameworks. I feel like everyone's using frameworks for all these things all the time. I don't want to draw on too long about this, but got this tiny framework for front-end stuff, which is a bit functional. It kind of feels like React. Like React had a baby with Backbone and Elm or something using Require. I don't know. That's kind of the way it feels, I've heard. it weighs like 5 kilobytes, which makes it like kind of small. There's a whole bunch of concerns. I feel like this is what frameworks are. Frameworks are a giant ball of libraries, glue code, and opinions. So to dissect this a little bit, giant ball, yes, they are like extremely messy, generally. They're like, you take a bunch of like packages that work well together, or like do one thing well, and then you suddenly compose them together to make it do lots of things. And the moment you like hit multiple concerns, you're probably writing a framework, and B, it's not gonna be pretty in the inside, generally. Also, the opinions part is very important. If someone's like, I built an unopinionated framework, you can just be like, yeah, probably not. Probably this is the way you reason about code, ergo you built the framework in your own image. It's like creating a little baby. But with a bit more control, because you get to shape it. I'm not sure if that's a great analogy, but you know, I don't even know. Let's move on to the next part, and not linger on weird analogies. What does a framework contain? Like a front-end framework, you probably need a little language that renders to actual HTML nodes, like DOM nodes. You probably want to like batch your updates so your front-end rendering is a bit performant. Else like your CPU starts to spike and you're like, oh, that's not great. You probably want to manage some data flow because you have like logic or do like XHR requests from like your UI or something. So you need data management. You need some routing because you know you've got like URL, so you need to do something about that. Also anchor tags and all that stuff. And you're probably want to build some components, some reusable little things that like have events on it. Like, hey, it's rendering. Oh, hey, we stopped rendering. Along those lines. So first thing, I'm actually gonna guide you through all these steps and like show off like some packages you could use if you were to build your own. this is generally in the browser how you build like an element. This is the lowest level you can go, pretty much. You say document.createElement type of element. And then you do element.setAttribute, whatever attribute it is. If you want to set a class, you call it class and put the values in there. You can update stuff. You can remove stuff. L.removeAttribute, I believe, is the other thing. Then you can append children, set text content, all this stuff. It's like combining DOM nodes. You create like a tree of DOM nodes. And this is the API for that. This is the fastest you can get if you're like building stuff in the browser. Like, frameworks might be like, we're faster than X, but they always have an overhead. if you were to like write a perfect code, this would be the fastest you can ever like be. But you know, it's kind of finicky. It doesn't really express what you want to do. So you probably want to have like a template language. In this case, you can use VS6 tag template literals. It's just a package you grab from npm, and you say HTML, whatever you want in here, and then you can append it to the DOM. This can be compiled down to like this stuff, which is nice. Probably if you're going to write your own framework, this is like the easiest way to go. I use it in my stuff. It's quite fast. Oh yeah, if you compile it, it's like super, super fast. I don't know. Next one, yay. I don't want to linger too long on all these slides. It's more to like give you an idea of the things you could be using or the things I am using. Because I don't know why. Oh God, let's not linger. I'm like, next up, batch rendering. So like I said, you probably want to like flush a whole bunch of updates together if you're like doing this rendering thing, because you've got your big render loop. Yeah, you want to batch stuff because changing the DOM is very expensive. Something people sometimes say is like creating DOM elements is expensive. And it's like, no, creating DOM elements is super, super cheap. Mutating the stuff you see on the screen is very, very expensive. So you want to make as few changes as possible. Like don't, you know, change the whole thing all the time because your CPU starts spinning, or GPU if you're fancy. I don't know. You want to be surgical in your updates. Like only update the things you need. Hold on, I messed up the order here. Am I going right? Yeah. Okay. So one thing that happens is if you're like got changes, and you make changes all the time to your thing and you don't throttle it in any way, your CPU goes to 100%, or like your browser tab crashes or your browser freezes or whatever. And it sucks. So what you want to do is you want to cap the amount of updates you can do per second to 60, because the human, I believe the thing is like humans can see more than 60 frames a second. So anything above that is like not useful in a normal setting unless you do VR or something. So there's an API for that. It's called window.requestAnimationFrame. You pass the callback. You put it inside the function. Then you call the function inside of itself. And this thing resolves 60 times a second at max. If there's less power available, it will resolve less fast. And this is what you call your render loop. Every framework generally has one of these. Sometimes people use, what's the thing? Set interval for this. Actually, I filed a bug for the new Webpack website today because they resolved their animation with a set interval, which means that if you like move away from the tab and go back to the tab, yeah, I'd like DM someone. that's how I file bugs. Anyway, you move away from tab, you go back into a tab, then set interval will actually resolve all the intervals it missed, like the moment you go on there. So like the animation fast forwards, which sucks because you don't want that to do. You just want it to like have one little extra tick because you're not on the tab anyway. So this is an API that gives you that thing. Makes for fast rendering stuff, means you throttle the updates, which means it's great for performance. Yay. You probably want to wrap it inside of this thing. So the problem with this thing is it runs recursively. So it will actually take 60 times a second, which is overkill if you have nothing to change. Like you're doing 60 loops of this thing, recomputing everything all the time. But actually what you want to do is you only want to update whenever there's something new. So this thing allows you to, it's called NanoRaf, you can npm install it. You pass a callback, and whenever you call render, you can pass it some state. Oh, I'm not showing it off here. The idea is here that it only updates when you give it new data, which is great if you're building like a framework like React. I'll show a bit how to use this later, but this is the main idea. Like this only updates when there's new stuff available. Updating the DOM. Yeah, generally, if you like want to do a mutation, what you would do is you would like select the element, like have some state and change attributes based on that. That kind of sucks. We're like all used to React. This is a React meetup, I guess. What we're more used to is something along the lines of this, where there's like state, and then you sort of like render it out back. So you make this a function of state, what's returned. Where was I going with this? Oh, yeah. So if you want to like have a little, what do you call that? Virtual DOM based on real DOM nodes. wrote a little library. It's called Nanomorph. It's really fast. it allows you to like take two DOM trees, diff them against each other, and copies over all the events, copies over like SVG, what is it called, namespaces, does all that stuff, just using real DOM nodes. So if you've got like a cool old jQuery plugin, you can like just put it in there because it operates on real DOM nodes. Super tiny, weighs like half a kilobyte or something, this whole thing. I don't know. But as you can see, the way you use this thing is you create some nodes, and then you create some other nodes, and then you compare the two nodes, and out plops like the new value. Then you like put it inside of this again, and out pops a new value. Which if you combine that with like a loop, like we just saw here, then you can like create like this diffing state-based render loop, which is useful, which is kind of cool. That's like probably the core of most frameworks these days. They work this way. Whether or not they use like a virtual DOM or like a real DOM. I prefer real DOM. I think it's cool. Third thing, Dataflow. Yeah, I was writing this talk today. Didn't really get to this. There's probably one thing I like need to mention about this. If you're gonna be doing, Hold on. Step back. If I say Zalgo, who knows what I mean? 1, 2, 3 people. Great. That's most people not. Most people don't know about this. I'm gonna teach you today a thing. If you like walk away with one thing, this is the one thing. Unleashing Zalgo is a very interesting thing. There's a post by Isaac Schlöder who wrote NPM. He was like, unleashing Zalgo is a very bad thing. Unleashing Zalgo is when you have a function that may or may not resolve asynchronously. It might resolve synchronously, it might resolve asynchronously. So what you want to do is have a guarantee that it will always resolve either sync or async. And this package is a way to enforce that a function always resolves asynchronously in the next take. How do I explain this? If it's already async, it will just resolve async. If it's synchronous, it will suddenly resolve asynchronously, which makes whatever function you wrap in this, it gives you guarantees about how the way it works, so you don't get weird race conditions. That's Zalgo. Zalgo is the race conditions. De-Zalgoing is like making stuff async, I guess. Weird programmer words, I guess. This helps with the Zalgo problem. You want to be using this if you're like doing anything event-based. Anything where you're like mutating state through like a callback, or sometimes you're calling like an XHR thing and resolving it asynchronously, do this, or you'll like regret it at some point. Be like, oh, why isn't it like? So yeah, that's the note there. Fourth thing, routing. Probably if you're doing routing, you want to do these things. So you want to render views, you want to handle history API, you want to have like a URL and like figure out what it means. So what is this URL giving me? You want to have parameters, so you can do /user/:user, which then would like resolve to whatever user it is. It gives you the username back based off the URL. That's a very useful thing. And you probably like want to cache routes sometimes. So if you're like doing this giant loop, 60 frames a second, and you need to resolve the URL every single time and destructure it every single time, you probably want to cache that, because that's wasted CPU cycles because the URL didn't change. Like, for example, a user clicked a button, or, you know, something else changed. So you want to have some caching in there to, like, again, throttle performance or throttle CPU usage. Wrote a router that does exactly this, called Sheet Router. The core API is like a lispy little thing where you like have arrays in there and you just nest them recursively, infinitely. It resolves internally to a tree structure, tree, I don't know. And you pass it like stuff and it will like resolve that. The callbacks here, I didn't write them out. I was like, eh, whatever. But you can give it gives you a params, like the destructured params. So in this case, it has params.username as the username. In the repo, there's like a whole bunch of more helpers to like deconstruct URLs, to like handle HTML5 history, to like do all this other stuff, but they're like separate things. This is a core router. Yeah, component lifecycles. Yeah, that's basically a router thing. If you're going to be using a router, I'd recommend this one. This one's like 2 kilobytes. I think it's one of the smallest ones. Even PageJS might be bigger. It does more, for sure. But not too much. It just does routing, which I really, really... Sorry. Little segue. I don't get routers that like do more than routing. I'm like confused by that. End of segue. yeah. Component lifecycle. Wow. Are we? Yes, we're still recording. We're still recording. Component lifecycle. Yay. So this is an interesting thing because actually you don't really need a component lifecycle. Well, you can't. Okay. I'm still like, what is my talk? What's my topics? I'm not sure. But so component lifecycle. There's probably two crucial events you want to have when you're doing components. The first one is, am I going onto the DOM? Am I being rendered right now? I might need to respond. And the other one is, am I being removed from the DOM? That's the second one. Everything else is like nice and fancy and sugar on top. Like it gives you more like, oh, right before I'm being rendered, do this. Right after I have been unmounted, do this. That's like, you know, a bit extra. But loading and unloading are the two basic ones. But what else? Has a user interact? Oh, this one's also really important. Handling user interaction. You probably also want to have that. So like a user clicks, a user hovers, a user clicks submit, a user disconnects their thing. Or me. I don't. Was it the user? No. Okay, it was me. So has it been mounted, unmounted? These are the fun ones. I actually implemented these like a couple weeks ago. Does the browser have time to render this element? Yes or no? That's an interesting question to answer in life cycles. Do we need to re-render or do we have like a cached version of this? Other interesting answer to question to answer. Is my element currently in the viewport? Yes or no? You know, you might like want to render or not render or like do stuff based on that. This is probably some of the stuff you want to have. An interesting other one is like on resize, which is not part of like the DOM API, I believe. You need to like create an iframe mounted inside of the other thing and then you get like on resize events. Maybe you want that one also, I don't know. basic interaction with this like completely DOM-based stuff that I've been showing off so far. You can interpolate like a callback inside of like your HTML declaration. This just returns an element, like we've been doing a whole bunch. And then whenever it's clicked, it fires this callback, which is just the way HTML is supposed to work. Yay. User interaction. I think this is pretty straightforward. Is an element mounted? There's a package for that called onload. Whenever something's loaded onto the DOM, it calls loaded. Whenever it's unloaded, it calls unloaded. It uses under the hood global mutation observer, which then it like watches the whole tree of DOM elements and then finds the right change event and then fires it on this particular callback. So while this syntax is really nice, we're actually using web component stuff under the hood. In my opinion, it's probably the only API. Well, it's not my opinion. It's the only web component API that I use day to day. make what you want from it. Lifecycle events, very useful. On intersect is a thing I wrote. My friend wrote the other one. I wrote this one. You can do like, whenever this thing comes into the viewport, you can trigger events. Whenever it comes into the viewport or out of the viewport, you can like trigger stuff. This is the syntax again. You pass the HTML element and you pass it two callbacks to call whenever the thing handles. It returns a function that you can call again to like stop watching for that stuff. So if you're like ever unloaded, you would also like stop watching. That would be like a nice combination. So you don't have like dangling observers hang around. Another cool one is polite element. So intersection observer? Yeah, intersection observers API. Intersection observer API. It works. Use the element. API is kind of complicated. Polite element is another element I wrote. If the browser has spare time, do you have spare time? Yes or no? If you like load a page, the page is generally a bit busy. It starts doing all this stuff. Your processor spikes. It's like rendering. It's like, oh God, I need to do all this stuff. And then after a while, it's like, oh, I'm kind of relaxed now. I kind of got like time. And that is when the we just had a talk about that one API. What was the API again? Request idle callback. Thank you very much. Yes. So you can use request idle callback to trigger a callback whenever that happens. In this case, this is an element that renders a basic element. It calls render basic at the very start. or on the server. Oh yeah, I forgot to mention, all of this renders on the server also. Just call.toString on all of these elements, it like works. But this render basic thing is triggered like on the server or at the very start. So you could like, instead of loading an image, you could just create like a rectangular gray box of the right size. And then once your thing has like time, you render the complete image or chart or live Facebook timeline thing, whatever you want. Cute little interface into like the that one API. how much time do I have left? Plenty of time.
1 hour.
What? Do I have 1 hour left? Oh my god! Let's build a framework. I actually bloody mean it. I just wrote a framework. The request animation frame is a bit laggy today. This is the code for my slides. By the way, it's all like chew. This is the framework I just wrote. And we're gonna like oh god. You need to warn me if that happens. I'm looking at my screen, okay? Like, see, I'm using someone else's adapter in the hope that it would be stable, but I don't know what's up. This is a framework. It's 50 lines, including, well, actually, how long is this framework that I just wrote? It's 33 lines. It's a unidirectional render thing with, like, immutable state updates, sort of. Cool, let's build that. It's also, like, really, really performant. It doesn't do all the component stuff. Touch framework 2.js. Cool. So I built the framework just now. Sheet router, sheet router. Screencast. No, I'm supposed to, I've been stalling with my screencast. Anyway, quick thing. We import these things over here. We create a new function called framework. I'm just going to go through it. We create like an empty router because we need to define it later. So we like pass it arguments. Oh, actually the API for this thing looks like this, which is like we say F is new framework. Then we say f.router is our routes, which is just a recursive array. So we say on the slash route, render main view. Cool. Then we say, okay, give us an HTML element because we want to render that on the DOM, which is f.start. And we pass it an initial state, like, hey, this is the state you start off with. And then it's like, cool. And then we render the element on the DOM. And then in our main view, this is the thing like we're rendering over here. We say, hey, give us an onClick event that increments a counter by one and render out the current count. That is the core of the thing.
Nice.
Then over here, so we return the API, which is HTML, start, and router, the three functions we expose. So you initialize it first, it returns like these three things. So in the state thing, it expects like an initial state. We render out the first time we call the router. So we initialize the router here. So now we have a router, we just call it, we give it like the current path name. Probably you want to do a little bit better than this, but whatever. We give it the initial state, and we give it a callback, the change function, which you can call to change the state. The change function is defined right here, which says, hey, render the thing anew with a new state. The second thing is a little thing that I dislike, but it's the API I wrote, so sorry. So the render function is a request animation frame loop, which is throttled, which is blocked by the amount of times we call change. So the minimum amount of times it's called is zero. So unless we call change, it like renders on the next tick. And the maximum amount of times this thing is called is 60 times a second. But the state is like changed all the time, right? So we cache the state. We always give you like the latest version of the state. Then here, inside of this loop, we do exactly what we did initially, which is create, call the router, which gives us, which resolves to the right route, which resolves to the right view, which gives us back HTML. And, that view is a function of state, and we give it also the callback, so it can, like, call the thing again. And we then diff the two things using nanomorph. I think we can delete this return statement, actually. Actually, I'm not going to do it because I know this works. why change it? and then we like return the latest tree so you can append it to the DOM. I hope this sort of makes sense. I'm just gonna like run the demo like real fast so you can see it in action. Am I running it? No, no. I think I need to. VMD, hold on. I refuse, here we go. Framework.js. Oh, I built my own webpack, by the way. It's Browserify based. Sorry, webpack people. oh, hey, localhost works. Cool, count. So then we go to like count thing and we like click it and like, yay, it increments. yeah, hold on, I'm gonna boot up my slides again. I'm like gonna say goodbye and then, you know, you can clap again. So we go back to my slides. Bankai, hey, I think this still holds the right thing. Batch rendering. Oh, hey, we went through that. Crickets, yay, yay. Thank you. should we do a QA? Questions? Do people have questions?
Yes.
You there.
So you mentioned there are some things that routers try to do that do not pertain to the router itself. I'm not sure, you probably didn't want to talk about that, but I'm interested in what you think wouldn't pertain to router and where you've seen that done. Yeah.
So this is an interesting question to answer because I don't want to talk badly about other things. So the way I if I'm like going to mention this, it's from a perspective of, hey, I have a different opinion of things, not necessarily better, but anyway, I'm being cautious here. I've seen this done in React Router, which has like it manages state. It feels almost it resolves asynchronously. I believe under the hood they might even be using promises. In my view, a router should resolve synchronously, because that is the fastest way you can like iterate through it. And everything around it, you can like create async state management to like trigger the router, but the router itself should be synchronous, which means it's like very limited in scope. I feel like heaps of routers like do other stuff. It's like way bigger in scope. I think it should be synchronous, and ergo, this is my take on it. Does that answer your question?
Or there may be other things, but of course that answers the question.
Okay, yeah, the gist of it, I don't think router should be asynchronous. The moment it is, it's probably already like a problem. You'll like run into issues, I feel. So, okay, someone else, questions? No questions? One question?
Of Iranian packages that you didn't write?
Yeah. So I didn't write onload. We used to use morph.dom. But then they switched to something else. I believe they like changed the API and it broke like on four different things. So I decided to like boot up, dust off like my old virtual DOM implementation. I didn't write onload. That's basically it.
So what
else?
What about what was it called? The implementation, virtual DOM implementation from.
Oh, Bell. I also didn't write Bell. That's right.
Okay, cool.
Yes. That was Substack, and then Shama, and then I took it.
That's basically everything is based on some kind of microlibraries.
Yep.
Kind of thing.
Oh yeah, I forgot to mention. Like the framework I just showed off probably weighs like between 3 and 4 kilobytes. That's like the whole size of the thing. If you optimize it. Huh?
Do you publish it on
NPM? Oh, what now? Okay. NPM init-y. Cool. Let's update the main, right? So we need to point main to framework.js. Oh, good point. What else? Our dependencies are in there, I think. Are they? No, I didn't save them. This probably won't work. Hold on. We can. Sorry. If anyone has like other questions, I can like answer them in the meantime. It's called framework. Yeah, I do this all the time. So we need to resolve this npm i-s sheet router nano morph nano raf and bell. Hope I'm on the internet. Anyway, questions.
What's next up for Chu?
Oh, so all the component stuff I was showing off. I built a library called NanoComponent, which wraps all that stuff, so you can like use it. And I just learned that it's very similar to what React Fiber does. But the cool thing of this thing is like it renders in every engine because it just returns an HTML element, like a DOM element. So I think that's quite exciting because it gives you like very fine-grained control about what you can do with the thing. Good share of the API. Hold on. this thing. I think this works. This works. Main. Let's see. Yes, we do that. And then we run npm publish, I guess. Yeah. Hey, ta-da, framework.
You realize you just contributed to JS fatigue, right? It's on your shoulders now. You're part of it.
Dude, I have a lot of packages, trust me. I'm already part of it. I think that was it for questions, if I'll be around. Oh, hey, we have internet. It's great. Hold on. Slash nano components. Come on, internet, work. Nano components. And then we like need to go to the right branch because I suck at publishing stuff. so this puppy over here is probably going to be exposed as true slash components. Hold on. I'm at 15 minutes of battery life, which is why my computer's struggling. With 2 kilobytes, you can like cache static elements, cache dynamic elements, do the polite element stuff, which is like placeholder and render. It's like an object you pass into it. Then you can do onload and unload on update, which is like the lifecycle stuff, the basic lifecycle stuff. And then there's the on enter, on exit to like handle if it goes in and out of viewport. Yeah, that's basically it.
So like my question would be, why is everybody using React.js if it's that simple to write your own framework?
You answer that. I don't use React, you know?
Maybe that kind of plays into what I was asking before about scalability.
Oh, I don't know. No, like, this is very bloody state. This is very scalable. Like, recently, the election front page of the Washington Post was like written using like all these libraries. Worked well, held up well, didn't crash. I checked. They were like, no, worked well. So it scales, I guess. Like Washington Post front end on like election day was lots of hits, I think. I don't know. Does that answer both of your questions, I guess?
Probably.
Okay, cool. No, let's do this later. I'll talk to you.
Okay, yeah.
Thank you very much.